good to have you join us on another edition of Women in Politics. And our guest for this edition, though not directly linked with politics in Nigeria, but it will be so unfair on this program not to have her as our guest because she's been part of critical decision making in Nigeria. And of course, she's influenced so many policies in the present day Nigeria. She's fought for the struggle for democracy. And of course, she's the head of campaign, the president for Campaign Democracy and President Women Arise, always fighting for democracy in Nigeria. And so we're here at her office to ask her about herself, about how she evaluates democracy in Nigeria today, and so many other things that interest you and I about her. You're welcome aboard on the program Women in Politics once again. I am Ebulomo Adekunle, your host.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the First Lady of the United States, Michelle Obama, the Secretary of State, John Kerry, Mrs. Teresa Hines Kerry, and Undersecretary of State, Wendy Sherman, accompanied by the 2013 International Women of Courage Award recipients.
During the past 20 years in Nigeria, Dr. Josephine Odumakin has handled more than 2,000 cases of government security agencies violating women's rights. These cases include everything from negligence to assault and killings. As the president of the Campaign for Democracy, she has personally led almost every protest, march, lecture, and workshop to encourage the rule of law and democracy in Nigeria. She has been arrested or detained 17 times, but she has never stopped crusading for the rights of the Nigerian people. For exceptional courage, strength, and leadership in tirelessly advocating for human rights, social justice, and women's equality and advancement in Nigeria, Dr. Josephine Odumakin is a woman of courage.
Good to have you join us on Women in Politics.
My pleasure to be here on Women in Politics.
We've heard about how radical you can be for the things you believe in. We've even seen it happen. We've seen it play itself out. And we've seen your travail in the hands of the military during the Babangida era, how you were tear gassed, how you even sustained gunshot wounds, and all of that. In a typical African setting, how acceptable do you think that is culturally, given the value the African culture places on a woman?
Well, for a very long time, there's been a misconception as regards the role of a woman in a society. But the thing really is that anywhere you find a woman is there to complement whatever is happening in the society. And one thing that has served as a sort of inspiration to me is one of the books I read by Martin Luther King, and that quotation that our lives begin to end the day we keep silent about things that matter. So I see myself anywhere I am, I'm totally committed to whatever I believe. And thinking that because one is a woman, then one should not speak out, or one should fold their arms and continue to agonize without organizing for change. Also, knowing that strategic role of a woman, that a woman remains the lubricant for the survival of any entity, and is like the brain boss of any society. So all that I've done, I did it out of passion and conviction. And also knowing that if I fail to act, that means my silence will be criminal. And if it is criminal, that means, is it just men that I expect to act? So all that I've done, I have no regrets. I will do it over and over again.
So it doesn't matter what the society or what tradition says about you, talking about culture, the fact that the woman should remain a conservative, not really talk out of so much passion as you do. And let's relate that to the family front too. Does it not affect the family? Does it not affect your role as a mother to your children and as a wife to the husband?
Well, taking you back from what you first said, culture. I mean, the question of having to keep women at the background, where women are not supposed to be seen, they can be heard from the background, is an archaic culture. A culture that does not permit a woman to be part of that building process. Apart from that, growing up, there are a lot of things I learned from my mom. One must always balance the whole front with one's career. And that has really helped me a lot. Being at the forefront of the struggle and also meeting a comrade in detention, he leaving me behind in detention, and thereafter.
My comrade, you mean your husband?
Yes, yes, yes. I met comrade in detention. I was detained in the lorry, and I was in detention for almost 5 weeks. My father was to sign an undertaking that I should be of good behavior. I refused. I told my dad I was an adult because I was very sick. So my dad left me, and I was handcuffed and taken by road from Ilorin to Lagos. So when I got to Lagos, Chief Ganifa and me saw me. I was being dragged. I had no strength. And Chief said, "Why? Why are you treating her like this?" So I saw a young guy just looking. So Chief said, "Yinka, don't you know her?" He said, "Is it Joe? Joe, is that one not a man? Is it the Joe I always read of in papers?" So I was there in Alagbon. Himself and Chief were released and I stayed there. So what I'm saying in essence is that women should be there to complement, you know, to complement that role. And as a mother, I had my first child in 1998. I was preparing to go for a press conference in Papa Abraham Adesanya's office. And I was helping out with draft and a lot of other things. So I just had a funny feeling. And on my way to Apapa, I dropped by at the hospital. And the doctor said, "Oh, this is labor." I said, labor. "Can this be delayed? I have a press conference 11 o'clock. And this is 8 o'clock. Doctor said, it's advanced labor. I had the baby 5 minutes after 9. Lucky enough for me, my mom was around. I left the baby, left my mom, went for the press conference. And after the press conference, I came back and I told the doctor I wanted to be discharged. You know, so, but apart from that, there are a lot of things that I have to do at home front. I make sure that, except when I travel, the homework of my two kids, check their papers. At times, I go for Parents Teachers Association. I go to their schools, but at times, getting to the school, the whole thing will be sound to like State of the Nation discussion. People will be asking me, "How is this side?" So that's why I decided not to be going for, you know, Parents Teacher Association, so that I don't necessarily divert people's attention. But in all, is prioritizing what one wants to do, how to balance one's home front, and how to make sure that when I'm at the Aluta level, struggle level, when I'm at home, they tend to complement each other.
When you were age 19, you actually became the secretary of Women of Nigeria.
Yes.
That is the Kwara branch.
Yes.
And from that time till now, you've been fighting for democracy in Nigeria. And that was the reason for the campaign for democracy that you run and you head presently. How would you evaluate democracy in Nigeria?
Really, since 1985, that I gave my life to the struggle and trying to get military out of politics, military was an aberration. And after that, we had that bogus transition without end. After the transition, we then had some other experiment of civil rule. You know, as I speak today, really, the democracy that we all yearn for, most especially the annulment of June 12th, where unfortunately we lost the man and the mandate, where people set, put aside primordial interests and overwhelmingly voted for a Muslim ticket. As I speak today, we find it will be suicidal for any political party to pick Muslim candidate, because our people are now being divided. They are now being conscious of ethnicity. They are now being conscious of religion. They see a country where justice, fairness, and equity does not reign. As we also speak, we know that people's votes should count. Everyone, for instance, I tell people that when I'm giving an invitation card, I see RSVP written on that card. So people should not forget that the RSVP, it's time for people to register. They must register, select, vote, and protect their votes. That's RSVP. That's what it stands for. So in casting our votes, we must ensure, and that is why we have to build that institution called INEC, so that it can be totally independent. So as an impartial arbiter, in the INEC can give us free, fair, and credible election. Politics, again, are politicians. There must be decorum. Politics should not be a do or die affair. I see the way politics is being played. People are being killed. People ballot with their blood. That is not the democracy that we fought for. People should willingly cast their votes for the candidates that they want. Apart from that, we've also seen that poverty has also helped in jeopardizing the electoral effect that we have in our polity. People are so poor, and for 5,000 naira, even less than that, people can sell their votes. So when our people realize that selling of votes is selling the power that they have, that they can use to effect a change, they will stop doing it.
Tivanese presents a platform with presence in over 30 states of the Federation. Be sure to be heard. For live coverage of events, we have the capacity to deliver from anywhere in Nigeria and beyond. Contact us now on 0803-471-8550 or 0803-724-9733, 014-533-407.
Our 24-hour news station.
Majority would admit that corruption has been the bane of democracy in Nigeria. And in the ongoing national conference, which you are part of, there's been this resolution adopted that it should be part-time legislation and not full-time legislation. Considering the fact that even now that we have full-time legislation, during proceedings, we have half of the seats empty. If we really adopt this part-time legislation in Nigeria, do you think that is the way forward, and how effective will that be?
Yes, like we have mentioned, corruption. Corruption has become hydropulse. Corruption has led to bleeding our country white. And that is why I always make reference to the fact that it's not Nigerians that should be killed. But corruption has to be killed. Kill corruption and not Nigerians. We've also been talking about the fact that running governance is one of the, especially in Nigeria, is one of the most expensive. And then if one just opposes the money that our legislators earn with what is earned in other climes, one will know that ours is such that is extremely expensive to run and maintain. Yes, that assertion can be justified, that we have our lawmakers that are heavily subsidized, maintained by government, by taxpayers' money, and they are so comfortable. But at times, you see most of the chairs are empty. They are not really there, you know, to sit. And some people have expressed such reservation that if lawmaking is full-time, and then when it becomes part-time, that means in doing part-time, some of the lawmakers might set up business outfits, they run their business, they have to do other things, I mean, in order for them to earn a living, that we do not have a telling effect in terms of the output of the law that we expect to be made. Well, I think that the most important thing is there must be a change of mindset. A mindset that says, it's one of my business, it's government, it's Nigeria. If Nigeria crumbles, yes, I can easily go elsewhere. I have dual citizenship. I have visas of all over, I mean that, all over the country. One thing really is that we have to imbibe. Someone, if you see an American is first an American before being such an individual. We need to demonstrate high level of patriotism. I will throw my weight behind part-time lawmakers so that at the end, we'll have a better budget. I mean, we talk about education, UNESCO. It should be like 26%, but what we'll have is Far Cry and several other things. So, but if we weigh the full-time and part-time, I will go in for part-time. And if we go in for part-time, if we need that Nigeria that works, if really our elected representatives are true representatives of the people, I'm sure they will still be able to deliver dividends of democracy. They will still be able to make better laws. And at the end, that money that is used to maintain them will be diverted to all other conspicuous and very important sectors.
Yoruba groups at the ongoing national conference have been craving for regionalization. They've been craving for resource control. They've been craving for Nigeria to go back to the way it used to be. How do you think that will pave a way forward for Nigeria if you also buy into that idea? And won't that fuel the disintegration of the nation? Because we already have this Biafran Zionist Federation that was going to declare a secession of the Igbo nation, which was foiled. We have the Boko Haram insurgents in the northern part of the country. We have militancy in the south-south. We even have kidnappings even in the west and ritualists. How will that be effective in Nigeria and not disintegrate the country if we want to back regionalism?
First and foremost, different segments of the country, they have their own rallying points. They have their own battle cry. Like you have alluded to, you know, what the Southwest wants, regionalism. They've seen regionalism being practiced in our country and how it has paved way to greater heights and development. A lot of them have read books. They have even seen what Ahulawa did in the Southwest and how the states themselves have grown in line with their own level of development, and how through regions they've been able to pull up and pull to that greater strength where dividends trickles down to all the segments, all the roots that make that building block. So therefore, regionalism as it was being practiced before did not really give room for secession, did not give room for people to just selfishly, you know, give their time and all they have to their region. But if we want to just oppose regionalism with what we have now, look at situating what is happening in this country. We have the Boko Haram people, the ravaging the north. We also have kidnappings everywhere. We have ritualists. Sad reminder of the area where some ritualists were seen.
Ibadan, Soka.
And I went there and I saw people's tongues. It's not tongue that was caught, the one that was pulled out. And I saw tongues, not less than 30. And some other things. You know, so it shows how we have so much devalued ourselves, our lives. But I think that, like what happened to the Zionists, the declaration of Biafra. You see the Biafra people, they talk about Biafra is Biafra. Come and see, that's Biafra. That with the genocide that took place in the Southeast, you could still see that people that belong to that segment of that region still complain bitterly that they've been shortchanged. You see people in the Niger Delta, when they talk about they have oil, but gas flaring, people cannot farm, they cannot fish. So when you take everything, you know, together, one will see that thread, that life wire that needs to pull everyone together is justice, fairness, and equity. We cannot tell people to continue to ask and advocate for peace when there's no justice, fairness, and equity. So if our people from the different regions, if they realize that to be a Nigerian, the people from the East will complain, they've not had president for a long time. They've not had this person for a long time. So if people are given sense of belongingness within the Nigerian entity, I think that binding force will bind everyone together. Even if we are operating at the level of region, if we are operating wherever we are operating at, we'll have that binding force. And people cannot go and declare for the Republic of Biafra if they know that we need a Nigerian entity. They are given a chance. They are well taken care of. They are not discriminated against. If the Yoruba also think that within where they find themselves, they are made to grow. So I think that the bottom line is that for us to have a Nigeria where justice, fairness, and equity reigns.
We cannot end this interview if we've not spoken about the Chibok girls. In one of your protests, you actually threatened that if these girls do not come out soon, that you were ready with some other women to go into the Sambisa forest naked. And I asked myself, was that just a mere threat? Or you meant that? And if you mean it, these girls are not still out. Are you still going into Sambisa forest and are you going naked?
We've had enough of talks. We want our girls rescued now, and they must be rescued alive. That's the only thing that will put smile on our faces. Not promises, not rhetoric, not empty platitudes that we are hearing now. Ultimately, when it's close to the time, our people will protest naked.
Yes, it's so sad that since April 14, that these Chibok girls have been held hostage. Even with another strong, you know, thing that happened yesterday, where 20 women were taken, adding up to the figures that we have had, and then the colossal waste of lives that we have recorded. Girls, that part of the country where education, people are to be pampered, they are to be literally begged to go to school, and we have young girls in school, and they were taken hostage since April 14. A night, a day that is spent with terrorists, is like 1,000 years. And the reason why it wasn't just an empty threat, the reason why I threatened that if these girls are not rescued, that I will lead women to Sambisa half naked. I tell you that our letter is out, the letter that we have written to the chief of staff, first to inform, because we are now being told that people coming around are hampering the rescue team, and that they do not want to endanger their people or anybody's lives. So that has given room why we have to write, and we are still waiting for the response of our letter that informing that we are going to come, and our coming is for us to storm the forest, and we storm the forest half naked for them to know that we really mean what we say. Dora was Professor Dora Akuni. Honestly, it's almost difficult for me to speak about Dora in the past, having known her for some time and having even seen her at the conference and chatted with her. She was so dogged, committed. We knew how she fought fake drugs with that tenacity, her passion. When she was even minister, information, We knew what she did in letting Nigerians realize the status of our then president, Yar'Adua. Again, considering how that cancer has taken toll on her physical appearance, Dora came. When I came in, I was racing to go and take my seat. And somebody just moved my back and I looked. I almost fainted. Because I've seen and I've read a lot of things. Yet seeing Dora physically. And the minute I saw her, then the chairman of the conference called that we should go. So we went back to our seat. Her contribution that day, she had a small piece where she was originally. And she told us what we could do to make the conference work. By the time she was summing up, she said, I leave you with this parting words. The moment she said, I leave you with this parting words, I developed this pimples. With this parting words,
Mr. Chairman, distinguished delegates, I leave you with the words of this Greek proverb. A society grows great when old men plant trees whose shade they know they shall never sit in. Thank you.
That's wherever we find ourselves, we must always think about Nigeria first. Let us bury that self. We must always show that level of patriotism and commitment. And Dora showed it. That was why she appeared. That day, I could recollect, she was told to sit down and make her submission. But she stood up. She was on her feet and she was standing and making her submission.
If there is anything to hold on to on this edition of Women in Politics, it is the fact that you need to identify your passion as a woman. And once you've identified that passion, learn to run the course, giving yourself 100% commitment to that passion you've identified. And this is to dedicate this edition of Women in Politics to Professor Dora Akinyele. You'll be greatly missed, and I know that everybody would feel your demise. Because if there is anything we know you for, we know you for your honesty, we know you for your boldness and sincerity. And I know that if many women have your kind of nature and emulate the kind of characteristics you show forth, would have more women participation in politics in Nigeria at the moment. Thank you so very much for being there with us on this edition of Women in Politics. The next edition would definitely be more exciting than this. I am Ebunlomo Adekunle. Thank you.